and I am the Chief of Financial Operations for ACC. So in a nutshell, my job is anything that ends with the word pay, I have responsibility for. Vendor pay, civilian pay, military pay, accounts payable. So in that vein, the responsibility that I have here today is to help bring out and roll out DEAMS, a new accounting backbone to go ahead and run the financial operations across the command. So to date, we've already rolled it out at 10 other ACC bases, and today we'll run through some of the things that you can expect to go ahead and see as we roll it out here with you all. What I do want to mention first off is this will not decrease your funding. Likewise, it will not increase your funding. So I just want to get that on the table first. So my apologies to those of you who thought you'd get a pay raise by coming here today. But as we run through things, our clicker. Clap on. I'm good now. I think so. Quick overview of what we'll run through, and then we'll pass things on. First off, as we run through things, the tone from the top is very key. This isn't just something that we've created locally that we're going to go ahead and identify. This is not just a concern of ours, it is a concern of Secretary James. So as she goes ahead and pushes out, this is transforming the financial operations, but also this is a law. That audit readiness is law. So Congress will be checking up on us. It's not just Secretary James, though. As we go ahead and look at things, General Welsh's comments here, the first one is, this is not just a financial management issue. This is an issue for every airman. So every airman, and that's the big A, the capital A, whether we're civilian officer enlisted, you know, even contractors that are working towards the Air Force goals, we need to make sure that we are all rowing in the same direction on this. There have been a lot of other significant similar changes that are happening, and one being wing inspection teams as a for instance. So that is an underpinning for, you know, the local, those are local audits that you are already doing on yourself. So this audit readiness perspective is not just one that it's a bean counter dollar sign. It is doing the operational audits and making sure that we're all doing our job. So we need to make sure that throughout all of this, DEAMS, as we roll this out, the defense enterprise, so looking holistically at this, looking at the enterprise operations, we need to make sure that we're meeting the intent of our senior leaders and that we're implementing the strategies needed for our Air Force to succeed in the future. But how do we get here and what's our past? So for those of you who are savvy with your airplane history, so what I have up here is an F-4 Interceptor. The F-4 Interceptor came into the Air Force inventory about 1958. Good airplane, did really well. So in the mid-60s, it was flying missions in Vietnam. So it did a great job, but what happened? Well, it hit the end of its useful life, so by 1996, we had to retire the aircraft. So let's throw this corollary over to the Air Force and the accounting system. So back in 1969, really in 68 was the birthing of it, but 1969 we have this, Comptroller Office of the Future, you know, the Air Force Accounting and Finance Way of the Future. So the COOF rooms, if you remember them, they were really cool. They were cool because they had to be air conditioned because of all of the different computers in them. Here, see a couple of head nods from the chronologically endowed crowd, so thank you. But with that, we've gone ahead, and that was our first generation aircraft, if you will. We were flying our accounting system in 1968, 1969. We're still flying that same aircraft. So I hear the F-22s off the background right now. So I think that the Air Force is what? Fourth generation, looking for fifth generation, we're moving on. So it's about that time. The desire then is that we roll ahead and that we can retire this, arguably by 2020, as we can brown out once we roll forward and get this implemented across the Air Force. So that's sort of the in a nutshell, where we are standing right now. Looking ahead also, why did we get to this point? So we'll have some other history fun here. So this gentleman was the fifth Comptroller of the United States. Comptroller General of the United States, so Elmer B. Statz. So he took office from 1966 to 1981, and we kept him a very busy man. We made sure that as he was working with the GAO, that we gave him a lot of fun things to look at and to review. And unfortunately, he did do that and did that well, because the first report in 1969 they did, right after we have our new system, said that the status, progress, and problems in federal agency accounting. Not to be outdone, we said it, you know, come back in a few years and check us out again. So he did, 1980, went ahead and status, progress, and problems in federal agency accounting. So, oh, for love of God, help me. So let's invite his successors back. So they came back later, and 1990 then, we have another report that comes out and says, we did not effectively account for billions. Okay, things are getting worse. But across all this, this all led up to this act in 2003, this opinion that the Air Force did not provide the financial statements on a timely basis in accordance with, there's a whole lot of this. Let me get down to three main points for you. Number one, non-compliance with laws and regulations. That's a consistency from 1966 up until now. You know, that's the system that we have. Also, previously identified material weaknesses that we didn't fix them. And what else do we have? We have financial statements that are unreliable. So what I'm here to tell you is we have very good people doing very good work in a bad system. So that's what DEAMS is here to flip, is we need to get to a good system for the great people that are already working for us, and so that you can help do your job and do it better. I won't say it's going to be easier. Now, what do we learn from Mr. Stats? And that's this, that the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. So we need to make sure that we go ahead and try something new, better, that's proven. And this has been ongoing tested since 2004 up until now to make sure that the system that you're being given today to run DEAMS is a workable and viable solution to our county ailments right now. In a word, we had failed. So let's try and get beyond that and get over that. So what is DEAMS? So you can look at all the I words up here, you know, like the I procurement, I receivables, I supplier, but I'd like for you to look at it in a slightly different twist. And that is that if you take that Oracle Financials, okay, so that might be our FM main people, but if you take I procurement, contracting folks, if you work in contracting, anybody who's making a purchase, you know, there's a module that's attached. I receivables, so accounts receivable, you know, if you're making payments or if you're just collecting things in, you know, we've got our suppliers, LRS, and those types of functions. This is where it applies to you, I supplier. And then you work down below and you have the project costing, the project billing. Civil engineering is what comes to mind for me. So this isn't just a finance system, and I need to make sure that you recognize that this is a system that involves everyone. It is an enterprise architecture to go ahead. So if I want to take this words and say, what's the application or what's the historical perspective? Well, let's look and say, out of the new system and even out of our current one, what would we expect? We would expect timely, accurate, standardized, reliable, auditable, and the big thing for me here is single entry. How many times have you had to put something in one system just to have to go and rekey it in another system? So let's have that fixed by linking those and having the systems amazingly talk to each other. But if you look at what we had, what does this replace or what does this do? So we run through with ABSS and with IOPS and GAAPS, all these fun accounting terms. But we have three main systems. And if you go ahead and look at those three and what they do, and this is where DEAMS wraps its big arms around them to try and pull them together. But all collectively, those activities go ahead and they're the form creation. They're running through the business processes, doing the target loads, updating the general ledger. Okay, so what does DEAMS do? Well, DEAMS goes ahead and just brings those on down into one system. So we go ahead and replace those three main operating systems with just one. So there are modules out there to replace actually more, but this goes ahead to run through and gets us down the road. If you are doing some accounting entry and things, this is arguably, as a user, the biggest area that you're gonna have some changes. The line of accounting as you knew it, with EEICs is going to go away, and we're going to replace it with a standard financial information structure, SFIS. So that is DOD wide, and it's still a line of accounting. It's just that the main pieces of that are going to change. In order to do that within the DEAMS system, the project task expenditure type and organization is the Pateo. So that's the part that we change to, and that's just how Oracle talks to each other. So you will hear the terms SFIS and Pateo as in where you might hear previously line of accounting and that background. So if you, this might help visualize a little better for you. The top line, we have what the legacy system goes ahead and runs. So the legacy, I grew up in this, okay? I've got 20 plus years going off on the 57X, 3400, you know, 30X, you know, move on across. So you have the whole breakout. My comfort level is on the top line, but my future is on the bottom line. A few months back, I had a discussion at a staff meeting with Comac, and Comac said this: you either hop on the bus or you get run over by the bus. Ladies and gentlemen, here's the bus. Okay, I need to make sure that you understand that we need to be working on the bottom line of this, and that is the SFIS. Now, I think this will go ahead, but if you're in the back, we want to make sure that you can still see this. So this is how the run-through is across on it. And the bottom, these, they don't change. You'll recognize some of the same numbers from the top move to the bottom. So for those of you who have experience with the top line of accounting, DEAMS allows you to query or to search on that top line, you know, so you can hunt down the EEIC that you're used to, and it will give you the cross-reference to the bottom for the object class that it'll now be translated into. But you need to be aware, and you need to be sharing that wealth of information that you have from your years of experience with our junior colleagues. So our airmen, our lieutenants, our junior captains, to go ahead and say, hey, this is what I expect would have happened. This is what I believe is going to go ahead and take place. And this is what should be the result of the inputs. And that's where you need to help bring them up. And then you can rely on them for some of the more of the click-happy things with the computers and the mice and working through to make sure that we get to the right levels with that. But this is, to me, if you are a line of accounting user and importer, this is arguably going to be the biggest struggle that you will have, is to make sure that you understand this change and how it goes ahead and affects things for you. So that's how that rolls in. Now, for joint baselining, like, what does this really mean? Where are we in the process? What's our past? What's our future? Well, you can't know where you're going unless you know where you've been. So if we look at where we've been, this is where we are currently and what's been set up. So we are right now for DEAMS at 27 bases. So a lot of different tenant support organizations already online. You can get into training and get 38 different online courses to get spun up on stuff. And we are providing 5 classroom opportunities. If you look at the little orange guy on your far right, currently today's date, we have 4.4 thousand users. By 1 February, whenever you roll in, as well as you, Offit, Nellis from ACC, in addition, we're going to bring in AETC. Comes in at the same time. I don't care about as much as them, though, but others here do. But with them, we will go ahead and grow to be 6.9 thousand users. So to give you some graphical change on this, so here's where we are now. AMC started it all back in 2010. A couple years troubleshooting and running through with their bases alone, mainly at Scott for 2 years. And then they spent the past 2 years growing to get the whole command. We brought 10 of the 13 ACC bases on, effective 1 October. And then all of Global Strike came on. So as we go ahead and build, what's going to happen next? AETC and ACC. So we get up to 6.9. After that, then, we're going to go ahead and grab the reserves and the guard in June. And then beyond there, we go ahead out to USAFE in next October. And then looking on to PACAF in February of 16. So that covers a lot of the main bases, but we're still not done. And it's phased so we can get the different modules ready to handle the different work types, especially foreign currency activities, so that we can be ready for those units. Beyond there then, we go ahead with the District of Washington and Special Operations, and then bring in the cadets in the academy. And finally, whenever all is said and done, almost 23,000 users, with the last pieces of the puzzle being AFMC and space. So that just sort of shows you're at the front end of this. So, but it's not that you're at the very tip front end. This has been something tried and tested already through the AMC channels mainly, and with Transcom as it first stood up. And now it's being exported. But there's a whole lot coming after you. And we ask to make sure that you go ahead and advise if there are things that you would look at and do different or make changes to. At the end, I think today, Mr. Bennett, we are very honored to have the Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for SAF-FM to have him here. He'll give some success stories we've had from individuals who have already done the transition. But that perspective that he brings is that we have very good people doing very good things in a new and better system. But I need your help. I will challenge you, okay? You do not hear this often. Please try and break this system. Don't be scared by it. Nearly anything you do in here can be undone. Great. Which is really good whenever we've had people cite the wrong funds on things. Remember that long line that slid across the screen? That was a training line of accounting. We've had several bases go ahead and just type in that training line of accounting and actually certify those funds. Scott's not very happy when that happens. Because then they don't have as much money at that point. So, but after a couple hours, they get on the phone and they call and say, hey, give me my money back. So the transaction can be undone. So don't be scared by hitting enter. Okay, so this is where arguably the generational divide is pretty good, because the more junior folks, it's not that you don't care, but if you hit enter, you really don't care. You're, okay, you know, that's what I'm supposed to do. I read the training, fine. Okay, click. You know, whereas those who are looking going, well, you know, I need to check to make sure this is going to balance and I'm okay, I'll wait. Does my T account look good? You know, and on the other side, they're like, just hit enter, you know. So don't worry. You can help advise the younger crowd, and the younger crowd help encourage the more chronologically endowed crowd, you know, so you go ahead and get it. But I would ask you to take action with it. Don't be held up on anything. So, and I guess in the reverse of the bionic man, instead of we can rebuild him, we can unbuild him too. So we're going ahead. So whenever we're fully deployed, though, like I said, we're 22,800 folks. And how do we get to that point? So this didn't just start today with the town hall. It didn't start yesterday when I met with Colonel Allen and other Air Base Wing leadership. This didn't start back whenever we had a meeting with COMAC back in the May timeframe. This started years ago. But your situation, most predominantly, it's about a six-month window. So if we back up the truck from 1 February to whenever we went ahead and started announcing things, this is how the build goes. So you warn people, hey, it's coming. You know, eventually it will. So 1 February will get here. And then do the site profiles. So we've worked very intimately with the 633rd Comptroller Squadron as the accounting host to go ahead and run things and make sure we get data and information from them. Beyond that, we've asked for more personal information about who the users are. And then really today with the town hall is when we start to kick things off to get it all going. So this is your first indoctrination to it. Over the next 24 hours, plus, you know, we will be having one-on-one conversations between the DEAMS team that you will get to meet a little bit after me, and then also the 633rd Comptroller Squadron and some primary users, such as the 192nd CE, Comm Squadron, and some other power users with that. So if you weren't invited to a one-on-one, it's okay, we still like you, okay? But I would ask that you have questions or issues that you go ahead and forward them back through the DEAMS POCs for the wing. And that's, if I can have Lieutenant Shaw and to stand up, and also Ms. Finch. So one in the front, one in the back. Just see, recognize these people, okay? You are very welcome to, I'll tell you, you can call them anytime. I'll also tell you that there are only like two dunsters in the whole global, thank you. There are only two dunsters, I think, in the global, so you got a 50% chance of hitting me. So if you have an issue, please, you're very welcome to come to me as well. I want to make sure that if you have something that pops up, you know where to go and you know what help you can get. Because I'll profess to say, and I don't do this much in front of my staff, but I don't know all the answers. I'm sorry. But I have friends who do. And that's what the helpful part is. So a big thing about today is to get the communication flowing between you and others, and to make sure you know who else is living the same dream that you are, you know, that you can go ahead and work through stuff. So as we go ahead and work through, in January, we'll have some power user training. Power users with multiple roles. A lot of that will be focused on the 633rd Comptroller. Okay, but then the second through fourth weeks of January will be specific module training. So that if you have a function like, if you're a contracting officer, there you really don't want to know about the rest of the finance stuff. I mean, that's just the way it is. But you need to know about your contracting modules. There's training there to go ahead and run through that. There'll be other specific training to get you spun up on what activities within DEAMS you need to know. And that'll all be coordinated through Lieutenant Shaw and Ms. Finch to make sure that the right people are at the right training and that training is offered at the right time. So as you have questions or issues, please make sure you bring those up and we can go ahead. But it's not done in January, so that we just say, hey, set it and forget it, and February you're on your own. What happens then is, from 1 February until the middle of March, we will have dedicated people on site to go ahead and have subject matter experts and DEAMS experts to go ahead and help coordinate things with the 633rd Comptroller Squadron. So those folks, you'll meet the lead for that, Mr. Dave Spiker, right after me. He'll be the speaker, but Dave will be the one who goes ahead and really is the belly button and is getting the answers for Lieutenant and Ms. Finch as they coordinate your local activities. He's been with the program since 2005, so since conception, I would say, you know. So he's been working DEAMS and has a very strong background in DEAMS, as well as a very successful active duty career that he was able to leverage that experience with. So we're not talking about a Johnny come lately that we are giving you someone without experience. We're giving you arguably one of the best trainers and one of the most experienced people that we have to help run ACC's transition for it. So afterwards, and before and after, we will ask you for some pre and post deployment surveys to make sure that if you have issues, if you have good things, that we repeat them. If you have complaints, that we go ahead and change those and don't repeat those for the next session as we roll through. So we're here today at the town hall. So this is giddy up. Day one, you know, the first indoctrination that a lot of you have. But this isn't the only way. I talked about the training that we're going to offer in January, and that will continue, and that the on-site folks actually can do even more training 1 February and beyond once we start the implementation factor. The bottom line here, though, across everything else is Millbrook access. So there is online training that you can go ahead and do at your leisure. So as I told Lieutenant Colonel Farmer Ho yesterday, said over that Christmas holiday, if folks are looking a little bored and a little down, you can unwrap that present for them and just let them go on to Millbrook. Okay, so you can take some of your slow time or downtime there, if you have any, and invest it in the future that will be 1 February and beyond, going into DEAMS. So, but with that, I'm gonna, I think, turn the stage over to Mr. Dave Spiker, and he is the lead for DEAMS for the ACC transition here at Langley. So Dave, wherever you want to come up on stage, downstage, whichever.
I was gonna stay down here if that's okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Dave Spiker. I work for the DEAMS Functional Management Office. The Functional Management Office is actually located at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio. I personally happen to live near Scott Air Force Base, Illinois, and every day when I go to work, I work in the headquarters AMC building. So, but I do work directly for Karen Tony. She's my government lead, and she's the deployment lead, and she'll be talking here shortly. So a little bit about myself. The Colonel mentioned a little bit. I am a retired Air Force FMer, was in the FM career field for 26 years, actually was stationed here at Langley Air Force Base for 12 of those years. So when this opportunity came up, I was happy to come here. I know Langley's a tough base, because I was over there chief of MilPay, chief of travel, and it's I know there's a lot of work that goes on here at Joint Base Langley Eustis. So 26 years in the Air Force, retired at the right place at the right time to come on to DEAMS, 8 years on DEAMS, and I'm 39 years old. So that's amazing, isn't it? So I'm going to be the site lead. I'll be the face that you'll see from the DEAMS FMO most frequently. I will work directly with Lieutenant Shaw and Tila Finch. You know, we've got the title of site leads, but I got to tell you right now, we can't do it all. This is definitely a team effort. All of you are going to be using DEAMS, and so there's a part that you have to play in that process. So we've got a lot to do between now and 1 February, so we're going to need your help. So a little bit about our battle rhythm, which really is weekly schedule of meetings that we run. And you know, communication is so key to this, to the success of the DEAMS implementation. So just quickly to run through this. Normally, once a week, we'll have a team meeting with just our Langley POCs. Last time, we decided to forego those because it seemed like we were having too many meetings. We'll see how it goes this time. There is some value in just having a Langley team meeting, a scheduled team meeting, because if you say you're not going to do it and you're just going to talk to people as you need to, what I found is you don't end up doing it. So we may end up having a weekly team meeting. Then what we also have after that is a joint meeting for all 13 bases that are going live on DEAMS. And that's a great opportunity for us to pass out information to all 13 bases, to the site leads, without having to repeat ourselves over and over again, and make sure that we're sending the same message to all the bases at once. And then every Thursday, we have a meeting where we brief SAF FM, and Mr. Bennett has historically chaired that meeting. So basically, it's a meeting where we explain to him how the deployment's going, and it's a great opportunity. I mean, this gives your local site leads to bring up an issue straight to the top on any concerns that they may have for the DEAMS implementation. And then lastly, we have another internal meeting just within the DEAMS FMO and all the 13 site leads. So there's equivalents to me at the other 12 bases. All right, we have metrics. And basically what we've done to create our deployment metrics, we have these two checklists. And if you were to add up all the tasks that are on these two checklists, there's about 250 items that we need to accomplish to make DEAMS go live at an Air Force base. We're always refining this. We've changed a few things since the last go live, which was just this past 1 October. But basically what we do, we take that checklist and we turn it into metrics. Every item on that checklist, we either turn it red if it's behind schedule, green if it's in process, and blue once it's completed. So on those Thursday meetings that I mentioned earlier, where we're briefing the leadership on where we stand in the deployment, we actually take this checklist and show it and let them know how we're doing. So an item on the checklist may be a huge item, such as conduct training at Langley Air Force Base. Well, I mean, that's one little item out of 250 on a huge checklist, but the point is, that's one item that takes a couple of months to actually perform. There may be some other items on that checklist, which is like flip a little switch to make an interface point to DEAMS instead of the legacy world. So anyway, these checklists are all out on our deployment outreach site. That's what we use to guide the way. And so just so you understand, it's very detailed, and we'll need your help in working through all the items on the checklist. All right, user data collection. So we need to get approximately 300 folks here at Joint Base Langley Eustis loaded into a financial system, the new accounting system, DEAMS, with the right access levels, the right roles and responsibilities, and as far as requisitions go, the ability to have requisitions flow through the system with the right approval groups. So that's quite a detailed undertaking that we need to complete. And this is where we're gonna need each unit's help in making sure we get that set up right from the beginning. Now, for the most part, we do this with a spreadsheet. Up front, we do this with a spreadsheet of the 300 folks, whether they're an RA or just someone that needs to be able to go in and pull reports, or if they're someone in the over in the comptroller squadron that actually puts in MAFER every day. So we try to identify the 300 folks, what their role's gonna be, their workflow, what workflows they need to be in, and then that we actually end up using that spreadsheet to load everyone into the system. So, but the second part of that is we are not gonna actually get access to DEAMS unless you fill out a DD Form 2875. So that's where we're gonna need your help. We're gonna send out a tasker saying, we need all 300 of you to fill out this 2875. And you know, it's hard to get 300 people to do anything. And I know some people will be on leave and TDY, but the point is, please be responsive as possible. So one other thing that I need to mention is that we will be loading your Social Security numbers into DEAMS. So normally we don't necessarily go out to you and ask each of you for your social. Obviously the FM shop knows how to get socials because through pay systems and so forth. But this has been a sensitive issue in the past. So we want to make sure that we're mentioning it right up front that we're going to load your social security numbers in the system. We handle them very carefully through password protected spreadsheets, and it does get loaded into DEAMS, but there are very few people that actually have the DEAMS access level necessary to go in and see your social security numbers. So, all right, dual processing. So we're replacing ABSS, we're replacing IAPS and BQ, but we're not doing that completely come 1 February. We're going to go through what we've termed dual processing. And generally, what that term means is all new transactions from 1 February forward, we're going to process in DEAMS, and whatever's already existing in legacy will stay in legacy. So it could take a good while before everything attrits out of the legacy side. And although this may seem pretty, and it's fairly simple on the surface, but it does get a little more complicated than that. So I just want to give you an example of what we're talking about here as far as processing certain things in the legacy. So what originated in legacy stays in legacy. So let's say last July, a new contract was cut at Langley Air Force Base with 4 option years. So that, in July, in ABSS, someone went in and prepared a Form 9 and went over to contracting. Contracting cut a contract with 4 option years, but that Form 9 only funded the first option year. So now, here it is July of 2015, you guys are on DEAMS. Well, guess what? The second option year, based on our dual processing rules, you will still prepare that requisition for the second, to fund the second option year in ABSS. So that's just one example of these dual processing guidelines. Now, to help you understand this and to get a grasp of all the scenarios, we've actually created a dual processing guide. And included in that guide is every type of form that you could you create, every type of requisition and other forms. And it has logic charts in there that will help you decide, should I be putting this new transaction in the legacy environment or in the DEAMS environment? So that dual processing guide is out on our deployment outreach portal. And so it's important that everyone, the person that's going to put in a requisition, and everyone in those approval workflows understand the rules of those dual processing guides, because we need to apply them. There's just some cases where you just can't split certain transactions between legacy and DEAMS. So now, there are a few exceptions. So I explained some things stay in legacy, new transactions go into DEAMS. Well, when we go live 1 February, there's a few cases where we're actually going to take all the open obligations that are sitting in legacy, and we're going to actually convert them over to DEAMS, and then all future business for those will take place in DEAMS. And this includes the customer side of the SMAS SBSS process, any open fuel obligations that from the Purple Hub, Kylock, and PowerTrack. Now there's a few exceptions the other way, so. Because we don't have the full capability to handle it in DEAMS yet, and we're working on it, civilian pay is going to stay in legacy until the foreseeable future. And we're hoping for 1 October, hoping for the first pay period in October of 2016. So for now, all your civilian pay transactions will remain in legacy. And there's a couple other examples. Asset reimbursements and foreign currency that we need to leave in legacy. So, and the Air Force working capital stays in legacy. So 6C and 6B, those are all handled in legacy for the foreseeable future. So all that being said, what does this mean? So you're going to have some FY14 stuff, some FY15 stuff that's executed in DEAMS and executed in legacy. It's part of it executed in legacy. So what this means is you actually need to split your funding and load targets into the two systems. And so it becomes a little bit more of a tracking effort to look at your how the total amount of funds that you've you're executing. At some point in the future, we will just close out the legacy and move everything over to Deems, but that's yet to be determined exactly when that'll be. So again, in the meantime, you're gonna have to execute funds in both systems, load funds in both systems, and so that is a bit of a challenge. Last slide for me is the training slide. So we are gonna make sure that you are trained and ready to use the system come 1 February. So there's a few variety of ways that you can get training, but for an initial go live, everyone attends instructor-led training. So we're gonna have a couple of classrooms here on base, and we're gonna have some instructors come in, and everyone will go through Deems training. So I'm gonna a little bit about power user training. So a few people at Joint Base Langley-Eustis will be identified as power users. A power user doesn't get any extra access level in Deems, but basically they get more training than all the other users. So let's say that we decide that the RA in the Civil Engineering Squadron is a power user. Even though they're an RA for their job and that's the only access level they have in Deems, they're actually gonna get an end-to-end look at all the Deems functionality so that they have the bigger picture. So in other words, they'll even be trained on how the folks over in the Comptroller Squadron certify documents and post payments to the system, even though that's not their specific job. So we're gonna go through a process here of identifying power users. I would expect about 20 at Langley Air Force Base. We'll have probably 1 power user training. And so really they're just the person in the unit. We like to identify them as the person in the unit that has a knack for picking up new systems and will be able to help other folks as they start using the system. And maybe they'll put in the extra effort to learn it. So we will have power user training and we're gonna go through a process of identifying who those folks are. Okay, the end user training on site, so that is gonna be classroom training. We'll have an instructor, we have a SME that we have from the Deems FMO usually comes out and supports the instructor, a functional person that helps the instructor with the training. And I guess the part of the role in this where we need your help is, we definitely, if you schedule yourself for training, definitely make sure you show up. Two parts to it. First of all, you're gonna have to register for each training class. So out on the FMDLC, and then the second part is when you schedule yourself for a training, please show up or let your site leads know if you can't make it, because those are some valuable slots. A few other things, like I said, you'll register for the instructor-led training on the FMDLC. Also need to let you know, we have some web-based training out there. So let's say a new person came to Langley and April of this year, and our instructors have already left. Well, the way that they get trained on Deems is via those web-based training courses. Also, out on the AFSO SharePoint site, we have a lot of very handy guides and user job aids that'll help you actually step-by-step, helps you. You can look at it and say, I need a process of 4009 in the system. Let me go to this job aid, and it just walks you through it step by step. So we have a lot of valuable training material that I think will be very helpful to you. Okay, that's it for me, and Karen Tony is gonna come up and talk about some of the change management activities.
They have found in the past that I'm challenged when it comes to advancing slides. Sometimes I go through all the slides when I'm still on the first slide, and sometimes I'm on the last slide and it's still on the first slide. So now they don't let me have a clicker. So change. Admittedly, this is going to be a big change, the biggest change in an accounting system that we've had, and I would venture all of our accounting lifetimes. I doubt that there's anyone that's alive that was working in 19. Alive. They're still alive. They're just not still coming to work. that started in 1968. Is there anyone here that was before 1968? I didn't think so. So this is a huge change for us, and change is difficult. How many of you go to church and you sit in the same seat every Sunday, and if you go to church and someone has sat in your seat, that just makes you more uncomfortable? You know, you don't leave church, you do find yourself another seat, but you kind of glare at that person who is sitting in your seat. Or how about if you come to work every day and you park in the same parking space? That is your parking space, you park there every day. And you get to work 5 minutes late one morning and someone has taken your parking space. Just ruins your entire day, unless of course you're one of those that are lucky enough to have a reserved parking space, which I never have. Next slide. Don't you just hate it when someone parks in your space? Oh, I guess I should have asked him. Are you hearing me? If the people in the back will wave at me, if you don't hear me, I'll think you're very friendly and I'll wave back. So this person came in one day and someone had taken their parking space. So to make sure that that person in their space didn't ever do it again, they parked right next to them. Has anyone ever done this? I'm sure not. Because we are all going to embrace change, and we are happy that DEAMS is coming and is going to make us an auditable federal agency so that we are not in last place and are the only people without a clean audit opinion. Next slide. Communication is the key to changing, so we're going to make sure that you know everything that's coming along, that you're prepared and that we are there with you every step of the way. We have Dave that will be here for the month of February. I will have a SME here with you for the month of February. I will have a SME here that stays through the month of March. I will send someone back in April for a week if you're still needing help. We have DCOs that we have, that you've already participated in some of the DCOs, but afterwards, let's say that there was some part of training that it just didn't click with you, but we're through with training. We will do a DCO and go over that section of the way the system works, and so that you are comfortable with it. We, for the first time in, I think it's in November, we are having our first sustainment training class that will be down at Gunner, where if you ever go for Chris training or whatever your workflow training that's down at Gunner, we are now doing DEAMS training. So if you're new to if someone moves into the area after we have gone away and left you and you're up and running on the system, they can sign up for the sustainment training. So it's not like we're throwing the system over the fence and running off and leaving you. We are going to be here helping you, holding your hand until you're totally comfortable, but until at least you're comfortable enough that you can do it, and then just call us when you have a question. Next slide. So one of the mistakes people make is the fact that you're getting a new system, productivity is going to shoot up. That is not necessarily the case. You're learning a new system, you're learning a new language, and this is a significantly different way of doing business. So initially your productivity is going to dip a little bit. And we are making sure that all of your leadership knows that this is the case, so that you're not getting beat up, because why aren't you doing your job? Why aren't you as productive as you were yesterday? So this is another communication that we're getting across to everyone, is that this system is a little bit different. And for total honesty, DEAMS is not easier than Legacy. Even if it wasn't the fact that you're learning something new, it's not necessarily easier. In the Legacy systems, we had lots of shortcuts and things that kept us from being compliant. DEAMS will force us to be compliant. It's a general ledger system. You will learn your USSGLs. You will become more accountants if you're in the accounting side. On the other hand, if you're the person who's just creating a requisition, it probably is going to be easier for you. It's kind of like shopping on Amazon. But another thing I would like to caution people is, it's kind of like shopping on Amazon, and if you keep hitting that process button, you may be buying more than you wanted. So Give the system a couple of seconds to respond before you hit process again. It is a developing system, so if you get in the system and you see things that could be better, please let us know. As I am forever telling people, I can't fix things that I don't know that's broken. So if you see something that is broken, that something is not working for you, please, during the month of February, contact your site lead and your site POCs, and they will contact the help desk. But after we've gone away, if you have a problem, please, please, please let the help desk know. If we don't know that there's a problem, we can't do anything about it, and we really do want to make this the best system possible. We have a DEAMS outreach portal that you've heard mentioned a couple of times today, and I don't know how well you can see this slide because it looks kind of dim to me. But the outreach portal can be your best friend. I need you all to get access. You just need an AppNet email account to be able to have access, and there's ways that you can get the access, which Lee Peterson could help you with. So if you're having a problem getting access, please let us know. But we have all kinds of information out on the portal. The dual processing guide that Mr. Spiker mentioned is out on the portal. The 2875 instructions are out on the portal. Lessons learned are out on the portal. Questions are out on the portal. There is a link from the portal to the mill book. There's a link from the portal to the AFSO side. There's a link from the portal to the training environment. Anything and everything that you might want to know about DEAMS, you can access either on the portal or through the portal that will lead you to the place where the information is stored. So please become familiar with the portal and use it as your tools to help you be more successful in transitioning to DEAMS. Colonel Dunster mentioned the surveys. You should be getting the pre-deployment survey within the first couple of weeks of November. It's going to ask you questions about your, is there something going on that would prevent you from transitioning to DEAMS? It's a very short survey. I think there's like 15 questions, but we ask that you take this survey because it does give us information that we can use to make things better in the future. But more important, if you're only going to do one survey, please do the post-production survey, which we will send to you after you've been on the system for 90 days. And in this survey, you will tell me, was the training effective? Was the site lead effective? Was the system effective? There's the stuff that I use from those surveys to say, okay, maybe I should do this instead of that to make the deployments more effective. Obviously, it's a little too late to help you in your deployment, but there are a lot of people coming behind you. When we finish this February deployment, we will be up to, 6,200? We're going up to 22,000, so there's quite a few more coming behind you. So anything that you can do to help the next guy, we certainly would appreciate. Out on the portal, there's a place for lessons learned. So we take this very seriously. We have learned a lot of things in the... See, Dave says he's been here 9 years, I've been here 10 years, the system has been live for 5 years, so we've learned a lot in that time frame, and we like to apply what we've learned to make it better for you. And if you will tell us things that you learn, then that helps us get better for everyone. So you just go out on the portal, there's a place, you just pull it up, it's a Word document, type in what you want to tell us, and then we go out there and check it, and we can see things that you've learned. And it helps everyone. And now I'm going to pass it on to Lee Peterson, who's going to talk about the technology. But just before I give that to him, I have a couple of things that I wanted to add on to that Dave said. Under the dual process, and an example that he gave you was a contract with option years. And yes, you can leave that in legacy. But after you've been on DEAMS for a little while and you're comfortable with DEAMS and you work with contracting and DFAS and your customers, you might want to make the decision to move that into DEAMS so that you're moving more stuff into DEAMS and you're doing less in the two systems. So we're asking you not to do that on day one, But after you've been on the system for a little while and you're comfortable with the system, then start making smart decisions as to what maybe I should take out of legacy and put into DEAMS so that I'm doing less in two systems. I will also let you know that we have started working on the conversion programs now. We've put together a team to start looking at the conversion so that we can, once we have totally deployed, because right now that's our chief focus, is getting the system out to everyone and working, is that we will take all the data that's left in the legacy systems that's open and put it into DEAMS so that that time the legacy systems will brown out. So we have started working on that, and it is in your future. And now, Lee, over to you.
Good morning. My name's Lee Peterson. I'm going to get up on the stage, I think, because I want to look at you. Was it the right one or the left one? That's what I was looking for. How many of you guys work with Java every day? Just raise your hand if you love Java. Yeah, that's what I thought. And what I'm here to tell you today is don't worry about Java. We're all good with Java. That's a lie. No. I've been on the program for 5.5 years. I came on the program right before they went live with the complete system at Scott. And Java changes frequently. And in the distant past, it changed. It could change up to once a week. It's on a 90-day schedule. It changed on the 14th of this month. Because you guys, probably know what version of Java you have. If you don't, I can recite them back and the date they were put out, because I should be called Mr. Java, because that's a lot of what I do. But Internet Explorer 11 right now, how many of you having fun with that? Good. That's job security for me. Everybody is always concerned about how things are going to go and how you're going to make it work. That's really my role, and you're like, how can one guy, not a very attractive guy at that, how can he keep this going? Well, there's a lot of people behind the scenes, and obviously with the funding the way it is, we can't bring all of the folks out here that are going to help you as you deploy. We're just like the tip of the iceberg of what it is. And so we'll get through the slides, but what I want to make sure you understand is the older systems, the legacy systems, you've probably been told, yeah, that's not working right now, and we're not funding that because we're rolling to another system. Well, that other system is DEAMS. So if there's things happening in DEAMS that are keeping you from being able to do your job from an IT perspective, we're working those very aggressively. Okay, now one of the things I want to make sure everybody understands is how to get to DEAMS. Okay, if you got paper or one of those newfangled phones with a camera on it, you can take that URL down, and that's where you're going to get to DEAMS when we go live. And if you're like me and you can't remember anything, if you go to the Air Force portal, you can get to DEAMS through the Air Force portal. But that's the URL. And one of the things I want to make sure you understand is that DEAMS is a very complicated, enterprise, scalable system that's housed at Gunter. Okay? So you're going through the internet through a myriad of connections, and when you see this. And it's a CAC-enabled system, so there's no more passwords in the system. You log into it one time. Normally it'll ask you for your certificate twice. And I get this question because on my slide it shows you using the email certificate. For DEAMS it doesn't matter. But other resources, like the DEAMS deployment portal, the outreach portal that we'll look at in a little bit, you need to use your email certificate. And so if you just use your email certificate for everything, it'll work for a DCO, it'll work for DEAMS, it'll work for the outreach portal, it'll work for everything. And so that's the reason I do it that way, if you consistently use your email certificate. But it doesn't matter when you go into DEAMS. And the Air Force portal, and you might say, well, you guys keep talking about the Air Force portal, this outreach portal, SharePoint portal. Well, DEAMS uses some of the services from GCSS Air Force, which is the organization that provides us the Air Force portal. And each of you have a portal ID, okay? And on the screen, you see up at the top it says Clifford Peterson. If you open yours up and it says that, something's wrong. But just ignore that, and hopefully your name will be there, so insert your name, my profile, and you see down under my name, there's my portal ID. And some people mistake their portal ID for their email address. Now I know one person in this room has that anomaly. Ms. Tony, who is my boss, has her portal ID and her email account are the same. But that's not very common. Because I'm a contractor, I get that CTR, scarlet letter. And also, one of the things I want to make sure is, we were talking earlier about, because we're at a joint base, and you have an Army partner, is that correct? And so they may not have Air Force portal access right now. That Air Force portal access is a self-registration process. So they need to go to myaf.mil, and if you look on the front page, it says register for an account. And they go through it, and it associates their credentials from their CAC, and it will give them an Air Force portal account. It takes, I think it takes overnight or it takes a couple hours. But if you have, if you're in a unit where you know you have folks that don't normally use the Air Force portal, you need to make sure that everyone in your organization that's going to access DEAMS has an Air Force portal account. Now, I understand that this is kind of like just in time or late information, because you're providing your initial users to the DEAMS FMO on Monday. Is that correct? Yes? Yes. Katie said yes. So if you don't know what your portal ID is, don't guess at it, okay? Because that's the unique identifier. If we have any database people in here, DEAMS uses that portal ID as your unique identifier. And that's how your certificate is associated with your account, and which gives you your privileges within DEAMS. Okay, now, what we're doing is giving you all the information you need to register, okay? And this is true for this first round, which we're gonna start in February, but I can tell you that people move in your organization. They come in, they go out. They PCS, they quit, they retire. You fire them, I don't know, whatever you do with them. So you'll need this information in the future. And what I want to make sure everyone understands is all the information that's being presented here today is out on the outreach portal. And I think I have that URL in here, I think. But on the back of your CAC is your EDIPI number or your DOD ID number. But there's a problem with that. If you pull out your CAC, you can't write it down. You have to put it on paper. So if you'll, up on the right-hand side there, you see where the circle is. If you do the active client, which is the little mouse thing with the little blue card sticking out of it, you'll find that. My number is not 123456789 0, but I did that for I don't know why. And then that's the ugly guy there, which I didn't realize that picture was on the back of the CAC. And so I get accused of a lot of things now. And the other thing you're gonna need to know is your information assurance date. Now, one of the things you want to make sure of is that it's going to be within the last 12 months when we go live in February. Okay. Now, I know the domain does a much better job of telling you when that's required, and this is no different information assurance training that you're already doing. It's just that it is one of the steps that's required. So, you know, this is all the stuff beyond all of the complicated workflow that you guys are going to create with doing the DEAMS approval groups. This is just getting the account going. Okay, so mine was August, so I'm good for February. Okay, and I just recently changed the slide because the slide was February, but that was for the June deployments, but I was good for June, but now I needed a later date. And you know, it's the same one, don't let the guy use your phone in the coffee shop, and you're not supposed to chase the guy out of the coffee shop if he steals your phone. You guys know what I'm talking about? I'm chasing him out and I'm riding him down to the ground, I'm just letting you know. Because, you know, I got that new iPhone. And that thing, you know, they signed me up for a big thing on that dude. Okay. Now then, I'm going to ask you a couple questions. Does anybody know what an IAO is? Just holler out. Information Assurance Officer. Do any of you have Information Assurance Officers? You do. You need to know who they are. And it goes back to the registration process. So to get a portal account, you go out to the portal and self-register. Okay? To get access to the DEAMS Outreach Portal, which is a Air Force EID SharePoint site, it automatically happens when you provision your AFNET account. But if you're in the Air National Guard, you may not use your AFNET account. If you're in the Army, you probably use Army Online, not Air Force Portal and AFNET. However, your IAO in your organization can go out to this website. It's an ESD website. And really, the URL is irrelevant for you. It's your IAO knows that. And so you go out there, and then you see it says CFP. You go under there, and they can activate SharePoint access on an account. And it comes off of your certificate, because all of the PKI information is managed in a huge database at the DoD level. Because you realize we're all getting ready to go to mil.mil or mail.mil. It's all based off of that. And I see your eyes rolling back, and I understand. But I'm telling you, there's going to be some guy on the 2nd of February who says, I can't get into the outreach portal. And you're going to say, well, I don't know what to do. And someone's going to tell you to call ESD, which won't help you anymore. That used to be the way you would do it. You just call ESD. Now it's all done through your information assurance officer. They provision the SharePoint on the account. And how many of you have IT people in your organization, dedicated IT people? Okay, what I want to make sure you do is get with me after this briefing. I want to make sure I give you my card so that you can give that card to him or her. So if you have issues in the future, you can reach out to me. Now, I don't want you to short circuit the system and not call the help desk, but I also want you to have someone to reach out to. So if you have a question prior to go live, how to configure the system, yada, 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 I can help you with that. That's my role. Okay, here's another thing that you're probably going to need to know how to do. How to get a hold of the help desk. Now, the help desk is really unique for DEAMS. The help desk is at Wright-Patterson. It's in the AFSO at Wright-Patterson. The AFSO is also the same location where all of your other financial applications are managed from. You know, and everybody runs up, and eventually you get to Mr. Bennett. So these are all people that work for Mr. Bennett and the people that fall under him in his hierarchy. And so ABSS, Wide Area Workflow, Chris, they all work in the same room. Miss Tony works in the same room. I'm at Scott with Dave. So deems.helpdesk@us.af.mil. Now, the reason that's important is when you have a problem, I'm not trying to jinx you or anything, but you may have a problem. You're going to need to take a screenshot, because have you ever seen those errors that are this long? Well, you just take a screenshot, snippet, whatever. You can send it to that email, and then they have your name, your contact information, and the problem you're having, so they can start to tick it off and have the information. And I also give you the telephone number, so if you do need to call. And the thing that you want to make sure you understand is, if you're having an IT issue or a functional issue, so you don't know how to do something with a form, you can call the help desk. Now, the one caveat, you know, I know we've had a lot of asterisks in this meeting, but during the first few weeks, months, while you have Mr. Spiker and the rest of the SMEs here, they'll be your first line of defense, but that doesn't negate the responsibility to put in help tickets for issues that aren't solved at the base, because the tickets are logged and the issues are worked through the help desk database. So in order for things to be looked at, you have to have contacted the help desk. And these are a bunch of great people. Some of the folks that are on the help desk have been with the program for over 8 years, and financial background. So you're not talking to someone who's reading you a script. You're going to talk to people that can probably answer most of your questions. Okay, so remember, after the briefing, get with me so I can give you my card, so I can get in touch with, or you can have your IT person get in touch with me. And that goes for any question you have about DEAMS. I'll be more than happy to pass it on. And that's all I have. And now Lieutenant Colonel Marshall is going to take it from here.
right, good morning, everybody. My name is Lieutenant Colonel Lloyd Marshall. I am the Director of DEAMS Integration at SAP FMF now. Basically, what that means is I'm kind of the focal point of taking what you guys see, hear, sound, smell, feel of DEAMS in the field, translate that up, and make sure Mr. Bennett and the Chief Information Officer up at Air Staff knows what's happening with DEAMS. So how many of y'all attended a PDI probably 10 years ago, 8 years ago, where there's a big old display, DEAMS is coming, it's going to be the Cadillac, it's going to be the sports car, the little toys that you always get from PDIs, get the little stickers, the fake swords? No? Okay, there's a few, you remember. So that was originally, you get the nice Lamborghini. Well, what happened? We promised the Lamborghini, we kind of delivered the beast. Anybody know the movie?
Yeah.
Vacation, which is classic Clark and the Griswolds taking off. So after a significant amount of work that we've done over the last couple of years, we're actually moving on and getting you a pretty good Ford. I mean, it's consistent, it starts, it rolls, it keeps going, and building a sound system. And we've had multiple evaluations on that. The last one coming from APOTEC, which is the Air Force's Operational Test and Evaluation Center, saying DEAMS is on track for operational suitability and feasibility. So we're working towards that, getting the ideal car. So hopefully pretty soon we'll be upgrading to the, maybe the 500. I personally like the Cadillac version. So. 53 though. So we're going to move on and get you that good car. So I'm going to do a little brief summary or a little bit further information. So strategic importance, you've heard, auditability, all that good stuff. So here's something else. How many of y'all know who Senator McCain is, Senator Coburn, Senator Levin? Y'all heard those names before? Now why are those folks important? Well, besides they cause problems, they cause additional work because they're interested, right? So what committee do they sit on? The Appropriations Committee, and they do what for us? They give us the money. Yeah, that's why those guys are important. And they're about every 6 weeks, Senator McCain will send Mr. Bennett a nice little love letter that says, give me a status of DEAMS. So every 6 weeks, we're giving him a new update to where DEAMS is at. So the appropriators at a strategic level are interested in DEAMS and our fire progress. All right, now let's take this back down to the operational level. Where's my CE brethren at? Raise your hand, fess up to it. Got one back there, a couple back row hiding out. Anybody, do you guys do real property? Yes, ooh, real property. So back in March time frame, you guys had an assessment for real property. Do you have all of the buildings accountable, right? Oh yeah, that sucked, right? All right, so when they went out and audited, this goes back to audit. So when they went out to audit how many buildings, facilities we have, was the Air Force over or under, or did you ever get that feedback? Maybe. So were you over or under? Take a guess. We were underestimating our number of facilities or over?
Under.
Underestimating. Holy cow, you are correct. So how many were we underestimating?
A lot.
That's a real scientific number. All right, so plus or minus, we were actually underestimating about 1,500 facilities. You take that out, a small facility, it's probably 3,000 square feet. 4.5 million square feet we were unaccounting for. Why is that important? Well, when they go out for additional distribution and they're sitting there presenting this out to all the playmakers, General Welch has his, the CE guys come up, they got pretty little ORM charts to say if you fund us at this sustainment level, this is the degradation to the building, draws a nice little chart and says, there we go. Well, General Welch and everybody else is making decisions lacking the appropriate information, because now he's funding what he assumes is accurate, an 80% level. Well, 1,500 facilities weren't accounted for. So that 80% level could actually be making that decision to be funding at 70%. That might drive a different decision for General Welch and the company up at the Pentagon, the Puzzle Palace. And that's less money that gets sent to the MAGCOM. That's less money that makes it to the space level. This is why fire, auditability, DEAMS all plays together. Because right now, our senior leaders aren't getting informed with the appropriate data. So less money here, less money at the top. That's kind of the strategic, operational, and tactical levels that hits home for everybody around here. Now, one last little thing. How many of y'all plan on retiring and going back to work in some other capacity in the next couple of years? I got a few hands. So here's a personal level for DEAMS. Operational, strategic, operational, tactical, personal level. DEAMS is an Oracle-based system. Oracle is commercial. Oracle translates to other companies that use Oracle financials. So if you go to Indeed.com and do jobs, Oracle financials, Hampton, Virginia, there's 46 jobs right now that's available. And some of them, which has 5 positions, which I thought was interesting, if you know how to do Oracle financials, $50 to $70 per hour. It's not a bad little gig. So on a personal level, DEAMS is something you should embrace and look at, because guess what? You might not always be wearing this uniform. You might want to learn additional skill sets and jump over to the commercial sector if you want to. So that's my personal push on that. Yes, ma'am.
Google has saved how many jobs you can get in the world
if you ask you. Did I look to see if there are any jobs available for gas users, RBQ, or COBOL? So here's a short story for COBOL. Back when I went to college, I was one of the last folks to take COBOL for a programming language. And after I took COBOL, I figured out I did not want to be an MIS major, and I quit that. And my teacher said the only people that use this is the federal government and utility companies. And that was it. So moving on to that modern financial management system there. And then a couple other options. Colonel Dunster mentioned people certified other people's plenty. Heard a lot of snickering. So we've deployed this thing 5 times. And at least 7 times, people have cited Scott's money. Now, you might laugh. So the person inputting it got it wrong. The resource advisor got it wrong. The budget analyst got it wrong. The certifying official certified it and got it wrong. So 4 steps in there as a minimum where folks got it. So it's back to General Welch's statement. This is back to basics. Do your core job, do your core responsibility. As Bill Belichick says, you do your job and your team will be successful. So that's what this is all about. So with that, Mr. Bennett, I believe you have an extra item. I'll turn it over to Mr. Bennett. He's the Deputy SAF FM. And, sir?
Can you hear me? I want to get up on the stage. I'm not nearly as tall as the other speakers. And I think you've heard all the issues that I want to bring up, but I want to foot stomp a couple of issues and point out. Colonel Marshall, I did get an email from SAF GC towards the end of your discussion. I want to make it very clear. You showed a Lamborghini and a Ford, and the Air Force does not endorse or condemn either car. We support American made, and so there's no endorsement one way or the other. And neither do we support or endorse Oracle. It's a software that we use. So as long as we've got that out, we're good. a couple of issues to bring out. Colonel Marshall mentioned Senator McCain and other senators in ECSS. So that's, you know, not necessarily a reason to do DEAMS or not because senators are asking hard questions. But it is a point that DEAMS has very high level interest. It goes to the senators. It is discussed and described to our secretary. She is aware that when we deploy the system, we let her know how it's going. She's very much interested in it, not just for auditability, although auditability is critical, but DEAMS is building up Air Force credibility with Congress again in terms of our ability to manage IT systems. So we've got a little bit bigger burden than just deploying a FM system to help us get auditable. We're the next system after ECSS, and we're to convince Congress that we can do this right. And we can put out a system, and that we can do the change management, that our users are sophisticated enough to adapt a new system, and I know we are. And so that's a big burden that we've got. If we don't do well, if we don't succeed in this, and I don't, that's not really a choice, we will succeed. It makes it all the more difficult for other systems like Air Force IPS to go out. Because after all, the common line out there is you wasted $1 billion or $2 billion on ECSS. We don't want the tagline. And then you've also didn't do well with DEAMS. Why in the world would I let you do IPS? So it's important. It's important to get there. One of the items that we learned from some of the Senate investigations into ECSS is change management. Is learning, and we're here to make sure that you're properly prepared for this. So you've got a good team. You've got Karen, Dave, Lee, Colonel Dunster, great job up there, and Colonel Marshall. You've got the support of the Air Force. You really do. Colonel Dunster, I think you were mentioning about order readiness, and you said we got great people. We have processes that are pretty good. We should be able to get to order readiness. And he showed General Welch. And I don't know if you remember this, but during General Welch's confirmation hearings, me being buried in Audubon, I'm well aware of it, he was asked by Senator Iyad, he says, the Air Force is behind everyone. You're behind the Army and the Navy, and that's the perception up there. General Welch, what are you gonna do to get order ready? This, she's asking the prospective Chief of Staff about order readiness. What are you going to do to get audit ready? How are you going to make it a priority? And she's presumably basing her decision to give him the up and down vote on that, you know, based on that and other questions. And his response was, you know, audit readiness is important. It's something we're going to work on, as he articulated. And he said, my biggest challenge is exactly what you said, is systems and getting the right systems into the hands of our people. This is the right system. This is the right system that's going out, and you need to be aware of that. You talk about the AFLTEC report. 3 years ago, if I were up here and I were to tell you, is this the right system, I'd waver. We got a bad AFLTEC report in 2012. There's no denying that. But we got a very positive one in March of 2014. Very positive report. Program made significant progress, made significant improvement. It was on track for IoT&E, on track for operational suitability, operational effectiveness. So we got a system that we're putting out there that works. And if you don't believe me, believe AFLTEC. If you don't believe AFLTEC, it is an Oracle-based system, as Ed shared. And Oracle is widely used across the federal government. They've been using this at commerce, at transportation, at a whole host of agencies, probably about 70% of the agencies that have clean opinions and have been getting clean opinions use an Oracle-based system. So this, the software works, configuration works, it's really getting the change management. You've got the commitment of leadership. Just to share with you again, you know they asked the Chief of Staff about this. I told you we talked to the Secretary and you know, our success with end-of-year closeout and deployments directly briefed to her. The other point I want to make is our boss, the Assistant Secretary, Ms. Disbro. Her first trip, so she was confirmed, I want to say, in early August, late July. Her first trip out of the office was up to Dover, September 2nd, 3rd time frame, to go see DEAMS. That was what was important to her. Because she knows that's the foundation for audit readiness. So you guys are getting ready to go on DEAMS. It's important to my boss. It's important to her boss. It's important to the chief of staff. We've got the cutover checklist that we go through. We talked about the weekly updates. We're going to talk about training. Training is critical, and you'll see one of the airmen I want to highlight here did a great job of training. But you know, when they're those red blocks, or you know, they're not blue or they're not green, we're not making progress on them, I'm on those calls and I ask the questions. And I think I've reached out probably maybe to your uncomfortable, you know, good emails. I'm not afraid to reach out and say, why are we behind on training? And when, you know, I know we're all going to do training, we're all going to do that. But I'm following those metrics. It's important to be a part of that. It's important to be part of the details. And if we're not making progress, I'm not afraid to send an email out, and I'll reach out to Colonel Wallaker and team and say, hey, why are we behind here? And I like to CC my boss so she's aware of this stuff too. So those are things that's important, and it's the details. It really is. It's the details. It's no longer, we can't be successful on audit readiness, we can't be successful at big IT applications with just sort of feeding, you know, the upper leadership and saying things are going well. We need to dig down, we need to understand it, and that's my commitment to you, is to be a part of that. It's going to be a nuisance to you, lots of questions, but in the end, I think it's really going to drive the success. You've got our support. Training is important. I think your valuable training you're going to see after we go live. That's critical. I told you the software works. We've seen it at other agencies. I want to highlight, you talked about building space issues. One of the things is you gave it to DEAMS, and Karen, I think you alluded to it, or Dave maybe, about productivity. You learn about SFIS, a standard new accounting data, etc. A lot of data goes into it. It may take a more amount of time to put some of that data in. But consider this. One of the questions that I keep seeing my boss ask to our budget, to General Martin, saying, how much are we spending over in Syria and Iraq? How much are we spending on Ebola? Because she's getting asked that by the secretary. Because Congress is saying, I'm going to give you money for Ebola. I'm going to give you money for Iraq. But I want to know what you're spending it on. And you can only spend this much doing TDYs or this much doing this and this much doing that. And I want to know what you're doing on it. Well, when we ask for this information, she can't get it daily. We're told, okay, you know, given the number of data calls we had to do to give you information on what it's costing to do West Africa, what it's costing to do ISIL, is it's probably maybe every week or every 2 weeks. So Congress is calling up saying, I'm ready to give you a couple $100 million to do your mission. How much are you spending? What do you need? And then we send a report that says, as of September 1st. And they're saying, what? So DEAMS getting that timely information is critical. It's going to be critical to doing our mission. It's going to be critical to our boss's credibility. And it's going to ease your workload later on. That graph where I dropped down productivity, if you consider and saying, okay, now I may be taking longer at the front end to put that information in, but I don't have Doug Bennett reaching out to me and saying, go pull all this data and summarize it and give me 20 spreadsheets to add together. If you look at it from that context, I think you're going to see it actually become a time saver. You know, but it's a bigger system, than bigger than just putting in information. So let's go to the next slide. So the one thing I want to do about DEAMS is, you saw Ed, you've been with the program for 2 years. Lee, you said 5 years. Dave, you were with 10 or 11, and Karen with 10 years. I add that up, it's talking 26 or 27 years of people on the system working, right? When we come out to you, you got 300 users. So within about, and I'm afraid to do public math, but within about a month or two, you'll have more users, you know, for more time than these folks have on. You're going to learn a lot on this system. And what I want to footstomp what Tim said is, don't be afraid to go in and try new things on the system. A little caution on the breaking the system. you know, running huge queries and stuff like that. But don't be afraid to hit submit. And Karen, you only hit submit once, you know, don't, so you don't buy 300 different items. But don't be afraid to hit submit. Don't be afraid to put in the data and see what happens as you go about your job, because you're going to learn stuff. And so the first airman here, Senior Airman Manley, don't mean to walk in front of him, he came on in October 1st. And October 15th, we had a discussion. We have a weekly discussion. How's the deployment going? And a slide came up and said, hey, this guy, Senior Airman Manley, down at Barksdale, found this new way to load ADSNs in the system. But Karen and our FMO hadn't uncovered. It's not a shortcut. It's just a tool, a capability within DEAMS that they found, or that he found. 2 weeks. We've had users at Scott on the system since May of 2010. And we've had users out at Dover and, you know, four other bases for over a year now. Prime example of, Tim, your comment, don't be afraid to try new things. Go and explore. And I called him up. I said, so how do you do this? He said, I had some time, and I went in and explored it, and I found it. I mean, this is what we need. This is the innovation that we need out there, and anyone can do it. This is a great opportunity for all of us, because there are things that we're going to do. So, you know, conservatively, probably 10% of the capability of DEAMS we're going to be able to teach you. There's 90% more capability out there that you can discover and that you can share with other users. So don't be afraid to go out and do that. So great job. It really is a big opportunity. Next slide. Okay, so Senior Airman McKenzie, he was out at Dover. And so this is really a great sort of leadership innovation. We talked earlier about leadership and how important it is to have that to deploy the system. This is change management and someone sort of taking charge and moving out with this. So Senior McKenzie went through, he did all of the training, the 37 or 38 modules. He did this computer-based training up front, learn the system. You have a good opportunity. You have the holidays and it slows down. Got very comfortable with it. And now the classroom training, took advantage of that and made sure that he was an expert on the system. And so he reached out to his fellow airmen at the squadron and basically helped them learn the system. Was a great proponent for the computer-based training. So we all have different learning styles, but I'm going to ask, you know, the folks out there to reach out, do that computer-based training, really get comfortable with the system, take full advantage of when the instructors are down here the month before and the month after, because you can become an expert. You really can. And it's very intuitive. There's lots of tools built in the system, and we need that sort of leadership. It doesn't have to come just from the top. It's folks all throughout the organization who can drive that. So we have one more airman I want to recognize, Staff Sergeant McIntyre. So Staff Sergeant McIntyre looked at the goo and basically said, hey, you know, it's a very difficult report to run and to interpret and whatnot. And so he rewrote the procedures, reaching out with the FMO to get good procedures out there. And these are the things that are going to happen, you know, as we use the system and you identify tricks and new ways of doing things or new, more efficient ways of navigating between screens. We need you to do, to take that lead, to be like Sergeant McIntyre, to be like Senior Airman McKenzie, and document that, share that with the FMO, share that with your fellow users. You know, you got 300 experts, 300 people here who will soon become experts, okay? You need to make sure all of your peers across the organization become that, across ACC. So you're gonna be relying on the ACC bases that went ahead of you, and I'm looking to you to basically be the expertise that supports ADTC and the other bases they come on. It's important. You've heard about audit readiness. You know we're going to audit this year. That's going to happen. That contract is going to be announced December 3rd or 4th. I expect the auditors to be in here probably February, March time frame to get their feet. There's no doubt in my mind that they're going to visit Langley. You're a MAGCOM. You're near D.C. Most of the audit firms are going to be based out of D.C. You're going to be an easy trip to come down and say, we want to see how your target financial management system is working. We want to understand that. We want to get to all the processes. So It's coming. We're going to give you a great tool. This is a great opportunity to impress them. I want to tell you the audit. Don't be intimidated by the audit. I think the skill sets that we have in the Air Force for financial management are far superior to what I've seen at other federal agencies. I've been at Veterans Affairs. I've been at two or three small agencies. You guys know far more than what they do. Far more. That's not even a comparison. And the senior leadership engagement in this whole effort is far more than what I've seen at other agencies. So you will do well in audit. You will do well with DEAMS. You need to stay motivated on this. It's big change. The last time we did a system implementation was 1968. So you'll never have to do this again. And you'll be able to tell your children and grandchildren when they're using DEAMS in 40 or 50 years that you were part of the team that brought this on. So thank you. If you have any questions, I know the team is up here for all questions too.
So now we'll open up to questions. The team will be up here for the next 35 minutes. So if you have any questions, throw them to us.
Certainly, most of the 63rd Cultural Squadron. For the forums that are on the portal, are those being monitored by anybody so that these so-called maybe shortcuts or helpful tools aren't just exactly that, just shortcuts, and that we are meeting or doing the things correctly?
Yes. All of the tenants, if there's a guard unit that's anywhere close, we pick pick up that guard unit. If there's a reserve unit, we pick up the reserve unit. But we don't necessarily have a POC for every unit. Now, it might be helpful for you to have a POC who works with our POCs to make sure that you're getting the information out to everyone in the guard. Our POC with the guard is at the Air National Guard headquarters level. But please reach out to us if you're not getting what you the help that you need.
I am Roger McGowan. I'm a contracting officer with ACC AMIC. My question is basically the DEAMS training itself is going to integrate IAPS and ABS and the financial part of everything. Is it going to be functionally specific training just to the acquisition folks? Or are we going to be getting into the weeds with all three systems that are out there right now, like getting in the weeds of accounting, where we might, you know, we do a lot of member processing and approval, and are we going to have the type of training that's just going to focus on these areas, or is everybody going to get the same training across the entire spectrum of all functions?
So my answer to you is also going to be yes. So we have what we call as a basic introductory course that we can make everyone take that gives you the navigation and some reports and some basic forms, but then we also have further DCOs with the contracting community so that we tell you specifically the things that you need to know from a contracting perspective. And do you get some things in that basic information course that you won't use? Yes, because it's a course that's intended to cover everyone because it's got the basics in it. But do we give you an additional opportunity so that we train exactly what that you need to know? The answer to that is yes also.
We'll also have some specific one-on-one training tomorrow that we have AMIC and CONS invited to tomorrow afternoon. So I think we're working with Kathy Day and other the other CONS folks in addition to the AMIC rep to go ahead and make sure. So we'll run through some pretty specific questions at that point to help set the stage and make sure that you get set up with the right module and the right training to go online for that.
Specific question, let me make sure I get with you afterwards so I can give you my contact information. So your point of contact, you get with me so we can answer any of those questions. DEAMS, Oracle has worked with all of the Javas for a couple of the last three or four releases, and there are multiple family classes of Java that will work with DEAMS.
Okay.
So 67 was a main release of Java in July. And then 67 was an incremental release that fixed some bugs. So it was a short-circuited implementation. The Air Force moved to it, but a lot of business and some other organizations did not. So 65 will work.
Thank you.
Everyone looks so excited. I appreciate your time. I am not the host. I do want to make sure Colonel Farmer, go ahead and stand up and let them have target lock on. But she is the comptroller for Joint Base Langley Eustis. Between her and her team with Lieutenant Shaw and Ms. Finch, as well as my staff from ACC, I have Mr. Kent Cunningham here as my lead accountant. We are all here to help, and it's not just the IG. You know, we're here to help. You know, and you say we're glad to see you, but we do want to say if you need something, please go ahead and make sure you get a card from Lee to make sure that you get any IT help. You get Mr. Spiker's information as a focal point within the squad whenever he's here for those upcoming months. And if you have any issue that you don't feel you're getting an answer with, you're very welcome to come to me. Okay, come to me personally, and I will get you connected up with the people that you need to be. But I appreciate your time. Mr. Bennett, any closing comments you'd like to have?
I do have one closing comment. And so I've asked this question before, and I want to ask it in front of everyone here. So Ken and Gladys, I want to ask you to reconsider your retirement. I see their heads going up and down. I'm sure they're going up and down. If they don't reconsider, I've asked that you please invite me down to your retirement. And certainly want to recognize and appreciate your service for many, many years to the Air Force. So thank you.
Hey, how's it going, sir?
Thank you.